Welcome to Innovation in Government. I'm your host, Jason Miller. My guest today is Dave York, the Senior Vice President of U.S. Public Sector for Genesys. Dave, welcome to the discussion.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Before we get started, let me set some context for our conversation. Dave, let's jump in the Wayback Machine for a second. 2001, OMB began marketing the concept of three clicks for service as a way to engage the citizen or the customer. The internet was still nascent in many ways. Websites were static. Transactions were surprising versus the norm. Now, we're going to take us back to modern day. 18 years later, the expectations of citizens have changed dramatically. They're visiting federal websites on their smartphones at the same rate as they do on their desktops. This is a dramatic change just over the last 3 years alone. At the same time, agencies are struggling to keep up with citizen expectations. Take the Department of Housing and Urban Development just for an example. In September, the agency released a solicitation to buy a forms as a service capability so it can take 950 forms filled out by millions of people every year and electronically capture and use that data. It's 2019 and HUD is still using paper forms. And unfortunately, they're not alone throughout the government. The last two administrations and Congress have made it clear that improving customer experience is hugely important. OMB added these requirements to Circular A11. Congress has passed bills requiring the IRS to improve customer service, and lawmakers in both houses introduced the Federal Agency Customer Experience Act of 2019. The FACE Act passed the Senate in July, and the House continues to consider it. And just recently, the 25 agency program offices designated as high-impact service providers by OMB released their annual customer experience action plans. Each plan includes two near-term goals agencies can accomplish within a year and a self-evaluation of how they're performing on five metrics: measurement, governance, organization and culture, customer research, and service design. So how can agencies improve their delivery of services to citizens? Well, that's where my guest comes in. Once again, my guest is Dave York, the Senior Vice President of U.S. Public Sector for Genesys. Dave, I mentioned Circular A11. It's one of many requirements. Talk maybe a little bit about why customer experience, customer service has become such a priority over the last 3, 5, even 10 years.
You know, there's probably three things, and you've touched a little bit on some of them. The first, obviously, is the mandates. Both the last two administrations, or the current and the previous, have made it a priority. So everyone does talk about it. Second, there is a growing cadre of government staff and industry associates who are committed to seeing customer experience improve across the government. For example, ACT-IAC has a very large number of both government and industry members who are committed to CX improvement across government. But the real reason, I believe, is what you touched on in your opening statement there is citizen expectations. They continue to rise. Pew Research published survey results in 2018 that showed that, as expected, millennials have a huge adoption of digital technologies and digital communication. But what's really happened is that's not just true in the millennial generation, it's true across all generational segments. We also published some survey results. We had an independent research firm conduct a survey across 2,000, 3,000 consumers and a large number of business users as well. And we discovered in that approximately 78% of consumers use a mobile phone when they are contacting a business or an organization for service and support. The same, and they in an equal number use that use their computer as well. So many of them are using multi-channel, if you will, in contacting the agencies and contacting the organizations. Now, anecdotally, an example: my parents are in their mid-80s. They just chose to move into an assisted living facility, so they had to downsize. They shrunk a lot of their possessions because they moved into a small apartment, but they still found room for three computers. Not sure why they need three, but they do have them and use them all. They have a couple tablets. They each have one or two tablets, and they also each have a smartphone. Why they need all those devices, I don't know, but they do use them, and that's an example of, just an anecdotal example of what we see in the industry and in the world at large, and that is driving government to seek to improve experience, because when the citizens' expectations aren't met, they escalate. They publicly escalate, and that creates a big problem.
It's interesting you bring multi-channel, and I looked at there's a great website, analytics.gov, GSA publishes, and it says where the people are coming from, mobile versus desktop versus tablet, which websites are most popular. Postal Service, still among the most popular websites. Weather Service, still among the most popular websites. But the way people want those services delivered is what is changing. And what I've seen over the years is a very strong desktop, everyone coming from the desktop, and now it's equal. About 47% are mobile, 47% are desktop, and the rest is tablet. And that's I think, is what you're getting to, is the multi-channel approach. And I think agencies have to kind of come into that as they're developing these customer experience strategies. What are you seeing from agencies as they are thinking about the changes that is happening in the market or the broader market?
So we are seeing a move towards multi-channel and really omni-channel. There's a lot of talk about omni-channel, but we are seeing a movement in that direction, but it's still largely siloed. And in our vernacular, when we talk about multi-channel, what we talk about is it may be an email, it may be a chat, it may be a text, it may be a website visit and a web form of some sort, or it could be a voice call. Voice is still a very viable and large channel in use across government.
It's interesting you say so largely siloed, meaning there are certain parts of the agency that are only focused on, let's say, how to deliver this service via a phone, and there's only a part that's delivering only by a computer, or what? Like when you say siloed?
Both. It's actually partly that. Partly the customer service organization may have a certain segment of its agents that only handle email, for example. But the other part is that they really do have a lack of integration with these channels. And I mentioned omni-channel earlier. I'll come back to that and explain what I mean by that. Today, we're having a conversation. Our next communication, maybe we send an email. Well, when we do that, we have a context. We know what we talked about today. And we have a history of that conversation. So that automatically informs that email communication. Then we might pick up the phone and talk to each other. Again, that third conversation has is informed by the previous interactions. Well, that's what we all expect when we contact the government. We want our interactions to be, regardless of channel, to be informed by the context and history of our previous contacts.
And right now, if I call the government, and I talk to them by phone, that's the only record they have is that phone. If I email them, that email is not connected to the phone, and the person who responds to my email may not know, I talked to Mary or Joe a week ago. And that's what that's challenge.
That's the challenge. That's where they're siloed. There is some level, or they're siloed in that the integration between them is such that it's very difficult for the person answering the email to see the history of what was in the phone or vice versa.
So how do we solve this? Because as agencies want to provide, and let's go back to the omni-channel discussion, how do they solve this problem of connecting those customer experience pieces and parts?
They certainly, as part of the technology modernization efforts, they can be solved. It is solvable across the industry. We see it in commercial enterprises. I call Marriott. I'm a Marriott guy. I call Marriott,
and they
say, "Thank you for calling, Mr. York. I see you've got this reservation coming up." They have that whole context. They can see that. Oh yes, you did call and change that reservation. Oh yes, you did call and speak to this person. So they see all that in my history when they answer the phone or when they get an email or when they get a web chat with them or something.
It seems like there's certain agencies that maybe are working down that path. Like, just let's pick on the Veterans Affairs Department just for a second. They seem to understand that concept of that omni-channel, that multi-channel approach, because the veterans are coming in from so many different ways, right? Whether it's in person or by phone or by email. Talk a little bit about I brought up A11 earlier, and that's something that's asking agencies to do kind of that self-assessment. What are you seeing from those self-assessments, or what are you hearing? And then how does the omni-channel kind of approach fit into how they're assessing themselves?
Well, what I don't see is the self-assessments addressing the whether they really are omni-channel. There's a lot of talk about omni-channel, but really I see it's more multi-channel still. There's no connection. That connection or integration is either not there, or it is very challenging to execute against. It's very expensive to execute against, very challenging to execute against.
And what's the difference between multi and omni? Omni is, for me as a layman, I would say, that's the same thing. Multi is many.
Right.
Omni is all. I mean, if you think of omnipresent or a...
Right. True.
Break it down.
And it is. And sometimes we get caught up in our own vernacular a little bit. Multi-channel really refers to the notion that I can allow you to communicate with me across different channels. But the integration between those, the conversational aspects of them that I was talking about earlier, don't exist. Omni-channel is much more about that conversational aspect. As an example, in Contact Center Week's 2019 special report on automation in the contact center, what they showed was that 40% of organizations don't even know who the caller is when it's transferred in from their automated voice response system. That's an example of omni-channel or multi-channel, but not omni-channel. They have multiple channels, an automated voice response, and then a live agent, and they can't even get the simple data of who is calling me to the agent.
Because there's nothing more frustrating than when they ask you, put in your social security number or your phone number, you do all that, and then when the person comes on, they say, okay, so who am I speaking to, and can you verify your phone number once again?
Yes.
And you're saying to yourself, I just did this.
Right, right.
And that's a clear sign that this is not, that there's an integration that is lacking. The difference between multi-channel, omni-channel, I think that's much clearer now, but give me a sense of how our agency is addressing this need for this omni-channel. I mean, A11 talks about it, but it's not an easy move for them. So how are they kind of getting there?
Well, one of the things I've seen in recent years, and I'll refer back to ACT IAC, is some of the work they've done with the GSA in establishing these centers of excellence. These centers of excellence, one of them is for customer experience, and it's to help the agency execute on an omni-channel strategy, not just deploy more siloed channels of communication with customers or with citizens. Additionally, we are seeing much more consolidation of contact centers within the agencies and within departments. While this doesn't by itself solve the omni-channel challenge or get them to an omni-channel, it does pave the way for them to execute against that and to consolidate at least the channels to begin with, consolidate the management of them to begin with across the agency, and then they can start to build on that and really build the context between those channels.
You bring up the Centers of Excellence. In fact, the reference I made earlier to the Department of Housing and Urban Development was basically pulled from that RFQ that they recently released. I know the Agriculture Department also is moving down that path of consolidation and improving.
Right.
Those are two great examples. Is it happening across other areas of government too? Or when you talk to your customers, when you talk to the people that you're working with in government, what are they saying about how they're addressing? Because the COEs are really very specific to just a handful of agencies. Are there other kind of initiatives or other examples?
That really varies by agency, and that varies by, but some of that consolidation of contact centers as an example, that is happening across agencies, even ones not involved in the COEs, as an example. But really the issue is customer experience is not a mission requirement, if you get right down to it. Customer experience is much more an enabler of the mission. But because it's not in their mission requirement, sometimes that's the first thing that goes when there's a budget cut to be made. Mm-hmm. And agencies and the government largely hasn't answered the question of why should I improve the customer experience? Because the reality is, you mentioned the IRS there's a law telling the IRS to improve customer experience. Okay, they have a law, a mandate, but why? Why is that? Why does that matter? You don't get another IRS to call if you have a bad experience with them. Sometimes we wish we could maybe, but you don't. And so as a result, what we have to do, and I think it's industry and the advocates within government have to do is a better job of articulating why this matters. So effective customer experience can really enable the mission in three ways. First of all, it's cost effective, saves money. And as an example, GovLoop research showed that a 1% improvement in public service efficiency would save $1 trillion by 2025. That's a big number, a nice number, and it would be a number. And the issue for agencies then is, great, if it saves me money, it might cut my budget the next year. Well, the government has recognized that as part of the president's management agenda and some of those initiatives associated with it, is that they allow that now, those savings, they enable those savings to be reapplied as working capital into the organization. So you no longer lose that. You get to use that working capital for other innovations or mission priorities. Secondly, when you optimize it, it saves time. I mean, it's just kind of a common sense thing. It saves time for you. And if you're saving time by not dealing with customer experience, customer service, then you can be doing your regular day job. And lastly, it results in a reduction of escalations. I don't think it's any secret. I don't think any agency head or staff member wants to get called up on Capitol Hill for an oversight discussion of any sort because a number of people make complaints about it. So that's what they're trying to accomplish with this. And I think they can accomplish that very effectively if they do so.
We're going to continue to talk about how they can accomplish that. But first, we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to the discussion, Innovation in Government, sponsored by Carahsoft on Federal News Radio, part of the Federal News Network.